This week's project, we will be installing a new set of seats in our Mustang. The Mustang will get a nice set of CR1 Corbeau seats. They're a reclining seat. We just unboxed them and we're ready to take apart the packaging they come in. Now the packaging is great, as you can see. Everything is really well covered, so it should come to you with zero damage. They're a great looking seat. Once we get into this packaging, we'll let you see what these look like. So now we're going to be very careful taking apart the packaging. Again, it's really well packaged, but you want to make sure that if you do use any kind of scissors, any kind of knife to get through some of your packaging, we don't want to get close to the fabric or anything. So do the best you can to use just your hands pulling at the tape and getting it to come apart. Again, if you do have to use a set of scissors to come through this, try and stay away from the material as much as possible. Always pulling away from everything so that we don't have any issue or any breakage in the seat material. So now we're going to pull the front seat, this is our driver's front seat, out of our Mustang in order to change it out. What we're going to do is we're going to slide this panel back to access the nut that sits and holds the seat. You'll see this nut here. This is a 15 millimeter nut. We'll want to remove both sides. When we come in here, we'll take this nut out and this nut out. Now these two have studs that are part of the floorboard on the front, which we'll cover in a moment. We'll show you the difference between the two mounting points. And we have our covers off, so we're just going to remove our seat mounting nuts. Again, these are a 15 millimeter. Once you have them loose, come right up and off. We'll do that on both. So now we're going to remove our two bolts from the front of the seat. You'll see that the orientation is different, and these are bolts. They use a 13 millimeter socket. What we'll do is we'll take these loose, and then we'll... Well, we've got our nuts removed. What we want to do now is unplug the factory wiring, and we want to do this in order to remove the seat. We have one plug there, and this is your airbag plug. Just be very cautious when removing this. Should come right unplugged. As you depress one side, you can pull on the other and it comes right off.
So we're now ready to take our seat out. What we want to do is we want to remove our headrest. This vehicle is equipped with TMI aftermarket headrests. But what we want to do is they remove the same, whether it's factory or TMI, is we're going to depress the release button with our bolts out, our nuts out, and our harnesses disconnected. Our seat is ready to come out. We lift up and out.
Now we're going to remove our factory seat belt. We're actually going to loosen this, which is already loose for us, but we used a T50 Torx bit in this. Once you have that loose, everything comes out. Of course, make sure that you disconnect it from the harness on the seat. So our Mustang was equipped with a premium package, which has a power driver's seat, and we do need to disconnect the harness in order to transfer it over to our new seats. What we've done is we've taken loose the side panel for the seat in order to access the harnesses here. This will allow you to unplug the controls. So we've taken the control harnesses out. A few things to note is this is held in by a clip up along the front. One is here, right along the front, and another to get your harness out for your seat belt is up inside here. Once you have those loose, you can come and take the top portion or front portion as the seat is set and pull that out. Now, one thing this vehicle does also have is a pneumatic lumbar, and we did have to access this panel here. You'll find it sitting looking like that. We've pulled back on the plastic clip that slides over the metal frame to reveal the plug. Now that plug, once taken loose, will actually come off. It is held in with a clip that pops out. And now we can take our harness completely off the seat and transfer that to our new seats. And this would allow us to keep access to our seat belt sensor and also our seat position sensor, which we also will have to transfer. So now we've taken the factory passenger seat out of our Mustang and brought it down to work on the underneath. What we want to do is we want to remove all of the wiring harnesses and sensors that are on this seat. It's a pretty advanced seat when it has computer controls for the airbag and a bladder that lets the computer know that someone is actually sitting in the seat in order to engage the airbag. So what we want to do is come in and disconnect these items. These are going to transfer over to our car and our new seats. And once we get these moved over, we can have that seat be complete. We also do have a side airbag on this vehicle, and what we plan to do with this is we're going to actually install a resistor, and the resistor is going to sort of trick the computer into thinking that the airbag is still connected. So this portion can stay on the seat, doesn't have to come off, and you can just leave that right in its place. What we're going to do now is we're going to take these wire springs off. These wire springs, along with holding the bottom of the seat and giving some tension to the passenger, also holds this bladder in place. What we want to do is we want to extend the spring, push it through its hole, and release it. Once all three are released, they can come off of their mounting point at the front. At that point, we can then slide our bladder completely out and get it ready to transfer to our new Corbeau seats. So now we're going to remove our bladder by first cutting these clips. These clips will hold them in the front. So you want to be careful when you do take them out that they don't shoot at you. But we're going to clip those with our side cutters. And that should allow us to now pull our bladder back. I'm going to guide it carefully out of our seat. Make sure we're not catching any of these areas. What we don't want to do is damage the bladder again. This bladder holds air. And what it does is it transfers it through a sensor that lets the car's computer know that there's a passenger. So now we're going to disassemble our seat. We're going to first remove the trim and plastic covers. Here's our handle. Small screw takes that out. It's a Phillips head screw. There's another Phillips head just below that. Once you lift the lever, take that off. Set that off to the side, and your plastic cover is going to push back and slide forward. You'll see it has to push back first in order to clear the spring that holds it in on the back side. We're disassembling our seats so that we can install the seat heater elements that go on the back and bottom of the seat. We're also installing an air bladder for lumbar support, so we're going to first take this area off here. We're going to be using a 13 millimeter socket. I'm going to take these two bolts off. Right now I'm just going to get these loose, and I will also need to remove the bolt on the opposite end of the seat so that the seat back and bottom can be separated safely. Now on this side of our seat, we have two caps to remove. We first remove the soft rubber cap and then this hard plastic cap. A lot of times I like to use a small trim screwdriver to get underneath it and pull up as you pry up. And that reveals our 17 millimeter bolt here. And we're going to get that loose now. Now on the other side, I've only loosened the two 13 millimeters to give me access and to have everything ready. So I'm going to fully remove this one. And I can just go to the other side now and remove our 13 millimeter bolts, and the two items will separate. So now what we're going to do is we're going to take our material for the seat bottom, and we're going to separate the back portion, which is the back of the seat, by removing the hog rings. Now there are dedicated tools to remove and install the hog rings. Of course, since we don't do upholstery all the time, we're going to use a little bit of ingenuity and pull our hog rings apart, giving us just enough room to actually separate them from the frame that holds them in place. Again, what we want to do is just stretch the hog ring. We don't need to break it. We want to reuse these. And this allows us to actually separate the material from the seat bottom. There is your hog ring. It just split in the center and pinches together to hold everything in place, and this is what holds your seat material tight. So now our hog rings are out. We're going to peel back on here, and there is some adhesive for the rear foam. We're going to separate that from the frame. Our seats do use a full metal frame, nicely placed in there. Then the seats are actually pushing itself and holding the Velcro. And now we can pull away at it. At this point, we're going to take our material, we're going to separate it from its adhesive. We're going to reapply the adhesive when everything is done and make sure that our bottoms are nice and tight. At this point, we can pull away to expose the top portion where we have more hog rings. And the hog rings hold the seat down. This material is held down here. There's a little wire that runs through this and hog rings to the bottom so this doesn't slide around. It's held in very tight. So we're going to pull our hog rings out and get this pulled forward in order to allow us to put in our heating element. Now our heating element will sit right down underneath the material. It'll sit flat. We will have to secure it so that it doesn't move or slide around, and then re-secure our hog rings, and we'll show you a good trick for making sure everything stays in place once we get to that point. So now we're marking our places, and this is where we're going to cut through, and this is going to allow us to reconnect our hog rings and have everything sit nice and solid, have the seat bottom sit nice and snug again so it doesn't pull away. What I've done is I've traced out an area in the grid. There's a grid in this element that actually heats. This area inside here is what we'll be eliminating, allowing us access with the hog ring back to the wire within the foam, and that will in turn hold everything nice and tight, keep it down where it needs to be. Nothing's going to slide around. So I'm going to demonstrate what I use as a technique to find my spot so that I know that I'm getting right into a good place with the hog ring. So I'm placing my finger here. I have a diamond-shaped portion already picked out, and I think that's going to be our place. As you can see, the wire that goes inside that the hog ring connects to is right there. So what I'll do is I'll come back to my side here and I will mark that diamond shaped pattern. Again, we want to cut within the diamond shaped pattern so that it opens up this area and allows our hog ring to come through, hook the wire inside, and tighten everything back up. So we're going to cut into our heating pad. And again, we don't want to disrupt the element underneath, so we want to cut within our triangle. The reason we don't want to disrupt the element is we don't want to cut off that area from being able to warm the seat. If you do damage any of those elements, the tiny wires inside there, that area will not function properly, and you won't get the heat that you're looking for from it. So again, we want to cut within our area, making sure not to cut through the actual wire in the grid. And that gives us enough space in there for our hog ring to travel through, catch the wire underneath it, and hold everything in place. Now the pads are also equipped with a very thin carpet tape or double-sided tape. So once we have everything in place, we'll remove the carpet tape and lay it flat against our pad so that will also keep it from sliding around. The biggest thing is being able to reuse our hog rings to re-secure the seat pad to the, or seat cover to the pad. I folded it back, and now we have just peeled that away, revealing the adhesive portion of it. And when you lay it down, you just go nice and slow, only a portion at a time, since we will need access to some of the other areas. So again, we want to make sure this folds in nice and tight and allows us to reuse our hog rings. So now we're going to reconnect our hog rings. Again, we want to make sure we catch the wire, that wire that's deep inside there, and we want to hook it. Once we have our hog ring hooked around it, again, with hog ring pliers, it's fairly simple. You pinch these two together, everything holds in place nicely. Since we're using some angled needle nose, we're going to try and get our needle nose around it, pinch them together. This pulls our material nice and tight back into the wire, holds our lower pad cover and our element in place. Now everything sits the way it should, nice and tight, nothing loose. So now we're going to reattach our lower seat cover to our lower pad with some spray adhesive. Now what you want to do when you're spraying a spray adhesive is you want to apply it to both sides, the pad and the cover in this case, and you want to let them set up. So as you spray your spray adhesive, make sure you try and keep it within the material you want covered. You want to try not to get it anywhere else, if you can help it. So keep your spraying just to the areas you need it. Now what we want to do is we don't want to just stick it right on there right away. We want to let the two materials set up. And when they set up, they'll actually not feel tacky at all. They won't feel wet or tacky. But when you do apply one to the other, the bond is very tight. So make sure you have your pad and your cover where you want them to be. Make sure you've pulled it tight enough so that there's no bunching on the top side, because you want that to still look as good as it did when it came from the factory. And now we're going to go ahead, check and see. Again, if it's still wet or tacky, it's not ready. So make sure you let it get somewhat dry and then slowly apply it so that you can get it to stay in place. You'll see it stays really nicely. Again, make sure you're pulling it so it gets nice and tight and there's no bunching on the front side. Okay, so we're not looking at a porcupine. We are looking at the transplanted harness that was removed from our factory seat. Again, we do need this in place, and we need this to plug into the factory harness in the car itself. We are going to be using our seatbelt sensor. We are also going to be using our track position sensor for the seat. So these two items will go to those two sensors once we have everything laid out. So we're wire tying everything down, keeping it as close and snug as possible in order to utilize this bottom flap and close it all off. At this point, I'm pretty much ready to do what I need to do. I'm just going to cut off these ends, roll everything in, and we will be all set. So now we're ready for our heating element. Now I've gone ahead and prepared this heating element and checking out the area that it's going to slide into. This actually overlaps our bolster, our pneumatic bolster here. So what I want to do is I want to make sure that both of these are free moving, but I want to attach them so they move together. So what I've done is I've cut small slits into the bottom portion of our element that closely match the holes in our bolster. I'll then use a zip tie to link the two. I don't want them to be solidly mounted, but I do want them to have some movement since this bolster is going to raise this element and move it around. I just want to have enough movement in that element so that it doesn't bind and doesn't get ripped out. So I'm going to go ahead and lay this element in. Now I've also gone ahead and marked the area for the tape that I'm going to peel away, again leaving this smaller lower portion loose. So I'm going to slide my element in place, making sure my fit is good. I want to get it up as high as possible, right here, all the way to the top and underneath. Everything is there. These will fold back down. The Velcro will still function the way it normally does. And again, down here, we'll have the freedom of movement required for our bolster. So what I want to do now is remove our tape. And we're going to go ahead and remove it from both sides, knowing that we're going to secure this now. It's in the spot we want it to be in. It's not moving very much from here. So we peel away our tape at some point. We get that off of our top. Now what we can do here, since I've cut the tape at my marks, I can peel those away from the bottom. In this case, what I want to do is now secure the top, getting again as high as possible. I know it's there, that's where I want it, and now the top is secure. We'll go ahead and move back down to here, peel our tape away from the bottom, all the way up, and secure our side there. and there. So now this will stay in place, no movement from it. This will move freely to allow the bolster to expand the way it should. Now what I'll do here is I'll connect my zip ties through the holes in the bladder and the slits that I've cut into our element. We want to keep these fairly loose so that they do have the freedom of movement that they're going to need. Again, we want to be able to move these independently of each other. I'm not snugging these down just yet. I'm going to go and cycle the bladder, give it an expansion to see if our movement is good. At this point, we will go ahead and expand it. Knowing that our zip ties are allowing for that movement. And again, the bladder is where we want it to be. Okay. So once all our Velcro and everything is in place, snug it all back down. Nice and tight. We bring our flap over again, making sure our leads for both our bladder and our heater element are routed through. Now we are done with the installation of our heating element and lumbar bladder. Now we're reassembling our seat by attaching our top to the bottom. So what we're going to do now is we're going to actually make a hole in the seat frame and get it ready for our fifth point for our harness. Our racing harness will include a fifth point, so it keeps you from sliding down in the seat. So we're going to get ready to make our hole now.
Okay.
So our step drill has done a nice job of making the hole in our bracket. What we're going to do now is put our strap in. Now what we want to make sure of is that we do have our strap in the right orientation to meet the buckle and allow for adjustment of the strap. So as you're laying things out, make sure you lay it out in the way you want to be able to adjust your strap. We're going to take our supplied hardware. We're going to add the bolt. We're going to add our spacer, and you'll see what the spacer is going to do for us in a moment. It's going to allow us to have freedom of movement in our strap. And this will let us move the strap back under the seat if we need to for our daily driving application and have it still rotate back around for our racetrack application. We'll take our lock nut, our lock washer, and our nut, and we'll just tighten everything down. So now we're going to tighten down this 18 millimeter nut, making sure that we get all the way down to the bottom with our lock nut. This way everything stays in place and secure. Still having that freedom of movement again that we're looking from our strap. So we're ready to bolt up our seat belt and harness. We're going to utilize the bracket that's already on our seat mount, and this bracket is designed to use the factory hardware. Now we've taken a 3/8 inner diameter sleeve as our shoulder extension. This allows us to use both the factory seat belt and our harness. Now this gives us the movement we need once we install our Torx here. Again, we're using the factory T50 Torx that came off of the other seat. We're going to tighten it all down, and with our 3/8 inner diameter sleeve in place, that gives us the movement we need between our two seatbelt and harness straps. This is our resistor plug. Inside there's a small resistor that gives us the right impedance to sort of trick the airbag light in the vehicle. What we're going to do here is we're going to actually take the top right off of this. We're going to measure 1/2 of an inch from this edge here up to the center and take off this portion of it, revealing our resistor. The stock resistor in this component will not work for our project, and we're going to change that out for a 2-ohm resistor. So we're going to remove the original resistor that came with our diagnostic plug.
Just removing it right there. We're not going to reuse that, so we're not worried about having any leads. What we do want to have is access to these leads so that we can solder our new 2-ohm resistor to those leads. So our resistor is in place now. What we're going to do is take the top that we cut off earlier. We're going to place that back in here. Now for testing purposes, we're just going to place a piece of tape around that to keep it together. Of course, to make it more secure, what we'll want to do later is come back in and actually glue the half right back on top so that it doesn't go anywhere. Again, right now we're just going to go and test, make sure everything is good, make sure the resistor is soldered well, which we can also do with our voltohm meter by testing across these two terminals and making sure we have a 2-ohm load on our terminals.
So on our seat installation, we did take into account that our driver is below a 5'8" height, and with that we know we need to extend the range of our seat a bit. We acquired these through Corbeau, and these are a seat extender, and they extend the range of the track, and they can actually move the seat forward another 4 inches, or allow us at least another 4 inches of forward movement, so the driver has a better pedal feel and seating position for his driving. What we also plan to do, while this gives us at least a 1/2 inch of height, we're also going to increase that height a bit more by another 1/2 inch. And we sourced these spacers through a friend's race shop. He had these kind of lying around, not really sure what he used them for, but we're going to use them right here on this location, and that's going to give us another 1/2 inch of spacing, and I think that's going to put our driver's eye at the level he really likes so that he can see over the hood of the vehicle. One thing we did do, now these rails do come with 3/8 holes already drilled. We decided to go with 3/8 hardware for the rest of the bolts, so we went to our local hardware store, got some 3/8 bolts, we drilled our frames open for the 3/8, and that's going to allow us a much beefier bolt. Now, since the stock seat material from Corbeau came with a grade 5, we stuck with a grade 5, since they really know what they're doing in the building of their seats, so we're going to stick with that with our hardware as well. We plan to use some washers, make sure that these spread the load of our lock nut and bolt combination, and also as some spacers were required. But other than that, this seat frame will go together for us, and then we'll show you how it assembles to the seat. So here we're showing the first track has already been installed onto our tracks. So this is the extender here on our tracks. Again, we did upgrade to 3/8 bolts in every location, so we did have to open the bolt hole in our track. As you see here, the bolt hole has been increased to accommodate 3/8 hardware. One thing that did get us is now with our nylon locking nut installed, this will drop right in and actually hold itself in place. It actually retains itself, so no wrench, since we can't get a wrench in there, we'll use the walls of the actual track to hold it in place when tightening our hardware. As you can see here, we did use 2 spacers to give us a little bit of spacing between our extender and our track so that nothing binds or hits. One thing to note, if you are going this route with the 3/8 hardware, any hardware you do plan to use, if you're changing it this way, we used a 1-inch long 3/8 bolt. The reason we did that is, since this track had to be installed prior, we had to make sure that we cleared the bolt that holds the track to the seat. With this configuration, we now have clearance that allows us to actually get our full range of motion from our tracks with no interference from our new hardware. As you can see here, this bolt has been installed, and this is the retention bolt for the seat to the bracket that will hold it into the car. This does have to go on first, or you have no way to get that in there. So please be sure to have that in there before you bolt your extender to your tracks. So now we're going to show you how we mount our extender to our track. This is the bolt that retains the track to the seat, and this is the bolt we want to try and miss. And that, when we miss that, will again allow us that range of motion we're looking for from the seat. So what I'm going to do now is install our extender. I'm going to be using our 1-inch bolt. I'm going to have our 2 spacers between the extender and the track. And we're also going to use
our lock nut. Again, the lock nut does slide into the track, and once you get it lined up with your bolt, you can snug it down. Again, we don't need to tighten it up just yet. We can leave it loose, and then we'll move down to the other bolt. One thing you'll notice is I have not installed this. The good thing is we're using our 1.5-inch bolt. We swing it out, we slide that into place, and we bring it back. Another good point about the washers being between the track and the bolt, although it does help to clear the track, it allows for room for our bolt. It gives it some space in there so it's not riding on anything else. So now we'll move on, we'll slide everything down, and we'll get our second bolt in. Again, our 1-inch, our two washers, and our nut. So after making sure our bolts are all tight on both sets of tracks and extenders, we have our spacers in place on all four corners, and now we'll just come up and we'll line up our bracket. We may only get two at first, and we'll line up those bottom ones. Again, what we can do here is we're going to have our washer, have our locking hardware, and just finger tight for now, making sure that all locking hardware is secured. I have to mention that just the fact that Corbeau understands that drivers are not all made to the same size, and having this extender available is a great touch from a company that makes a really great seat. Here we've installed the new seat and bracket. We're putting in our front bolts after lining up our rear studs onto the seat bracket. We'll tighten everything up. We've chosen to use the factory mounting point to incorporate our racing harness and our factory three-point harness. This way we still can use this for daily driving. What we've done is, along with the factory bolt, we've added another spacer. This spacer, again, being a 3/8 inner diameter sleeve that goes over the factory hardware. With that in place, it allows us enough movement in both harnesses that nothing will bind and everything will move freely. Once we get our bolt back into its stock location, we will then tighten it down using our T50 Torx. And we will have a nice solid mounting point for both our racing harness and our factory harness again. So now we're ready to put in our shoulder harnesses. These harnesses will secure to the vehicle's roll bar. This vehicle is equipped with a roll bar. If yours isn't, you would have to mount it using the supplied tabs. This tab is actually going to come off of this in order for us to wrap this harness around our bar. We have done that with the other three, and I'll show you how we do that here now. So what we have to do is get rid of our tab here. Since we're not using it, we're going to disassemble the strap slightly. We're going to take this off, just sliding it off of our strap. And you can save that. Never know what we could use that for. Now what we plan to do here is we're going to use a loop to strap this unit around and secure it to our roll bar. So we're going to bring ourselves to a point where we line up our strap, we loop it around our bar. Now what we're going to do here is we're going to come through three times. We're going to come through once here. We're going to come through the bottom side here. And we're going to come back over. Once we have our strap in place, we're actually going to come back over. And that will secure this strap to our bar. Time through.
Now our harness is secure to our bar and in a good place. What we'll do with the extra here is we're going to fold it all up, and we would actually wrap it like we did here using the little bungee that was supplied with the harness in the packaging. This way it keeps everything clean and out of the way.
So since we've added our seat heaters to our new seats, we needed to find a location for the controls. And what we did was, we didn't want to compromise too much the exterior of the console, but we did find this area right here just above the auxiliary and USB ports, and we were able to make our holes and mount our switches directly to the console. At this point, since our console is actually loose, we've also been running our wire. We're running our wire through and underneath the carpet and bringing it up under our seats.
So to protect our circuits for our seat heaters, we plan to use this fuse tap. We're going to go right into our fuse panel on the passenger side kick panel there. We're going to locate a not used or unused 10 amp circuit that is activated by the ignition key, so our switches will shut off when the ignition is shut off. What it will do is, this will replace the fuse in the fuse panel. We will insert the 10 amp fuse that's used normally for that particular circuit, and also have a 10 amp fuse that feeds this little pigtail, and that's going to go to our seat heater circuit. So we've located two fuses that are 10 amp, and based on the information we downloaded from the internet, are not used currently. And we used our fuse taps as our source for power for our seat heaters. Of course, we did check with a voltometer at those sources to make sure they were activated by the key switch. At this point, we're now ready to close up the fuse panel. We did have to clearance the fuse cover in order to make sure that our wire will go through. So we did clearance the fuse cover in two areas here, and that should allow us to actually reinstall the cover and keep everything looking as factory as possible. At this point, we're also going to remove fuse number 31, which is for the restraint system. This is going to allow us to reset our passenger side seat weight sensor. There's a bladder in the seat that senses when a passenger is there, and we will have to reset that since we've swapped over the sensor into a new seat. So we would remove the fuse number 31 and let everything reset. Place that fuse back into our holder in the fuse panel, and we should have a clear code on our dash.